Some of y'all are like, no, Kayla, this is not cool right now. We are upset with you because you just told us formaldehyde's in our food. Hello, everyone. Kayla here, and this is What the Kink, a natural hair channel. And today I'm going to be talking about this situation going on with the girls at OGX. I'm sure you guys have seen these posts on Facebook where people are saying, yo, listen, OGX is out here making folks' hair fall out. They post the link to the Facebook, they post the link to their Facebook. And I'm kind of happy to see that on almost every single time that I've seen this post come up, there's been at least one person who's kind of critical of it in the comment section. Because I feel like with situations like this, people don't actually go and look into it and actually research the stuff that they're talking about. And I'm not even talking like research on the level of someone who's like a professional. You can hit up Miss Google, and Miss Google will tell you a lot of this information, not everything, but it will tell you a lot of this information on your own. But I feel like a lot of people on Facebook don't critically look at things that are shared on there, and that's just a reality, right? So anyway, I decided to take a critical look at this, but of course, first we need to talk about what's actually going on. So I have some information here that I'm going to use to help me remember all of this stuff. So basically, there is a class action suit going on against OGX, which is this article made a point to let you know it's owned by Johnson & Johnson. Conspiracy. Anyways, so basically what's happening is the plaintiff is someone named Larissa Whipple. I think that name is super cool. But she is alleging violations of state and federal laws. She says she bought the products because of the false representation that they were smooth, nourish, soften, repair, and revive her hair. And what she feels like that was not disclosed was that it includes an ingredient or combination of ingredients that causes significant hair loss and scalp irritation upon proper application, she says. So she's just saying, hey, y'all are telling me I'm going to get all this good stuff, but you are not letting me know about a particular ingredient in this product that could be having my hair falling out. Shame on you. So the particular ingredient, among some others, but the main one that everyone, their mom and cousin, auntie is talking about is DMDM Hydantoin. That sounds really weird. I hope there's a better way to pronounce that. That sounds less weird. But DMDM Hydantoin is a formaldehyde donor, as this article calls it, or it may also be known as a formaldehyde releaser. And it is in the product because it is a preservative, and it is not the only preservative that releases formaldehyde as it is exposed to water, because we know that our hair products, typically they do get exposed to all the things. So over time, it slowly releases small amounts of formaldehyde so as to keep the product preserved and to keep it safe for human use. Now, this is not the first controversy over formaldehyde releasers. There was an issue with Tresemme. I think they paid some money out to people with the Tresemme situation. There is, of course, with hair falling out, not necessarily formaldehyde releasers, we have the Diva Curl and Wynn situations as well. So it is a tale as old as time of hair products being caught up in a hair loss type situation. So I do want to talk a little bit more about formaldehyde releasers and what they are, because you're like, oh my God, formaldehyde in my hair products, girl. But anyway, a formaldehyde releaser, aka formaldehyde donor or formaldehyde releasing preservative, is a chemical compound that slowly releases formaldehyde, as I said earlier. Formaldehyde releasers are added to prevent microbial growth and extend shelf life. Now, this is important because that's why you can order things and they come through the mail and they make it to you and they're still usable. Or why you can go to the store and buy something that's been sitting on the shelves for who knows how long and it's still safe for you to use. And also how you can have something in your little stash up at your house and you can have it there for a year or so and it's still safe to use. It's due to preservatives being in the product, and many preservatives are formaldehyde releasers. Not all, but many of them are. And they give a list here of some of the formaldehyde releasers. You got quaternium 15, DMDM Hydantoin, of course, and different types of ureas. And this one is benzyl hemiformal. Never seen that in my life. But anyway, they can be found in cosmetics, resins and plastics, and their other uses is that they can be in the production of fertilizers, lysing agents for cells, in vitro diagnostic reagents. Ooh, photochemicals and press room chemicals. Cool. All right, so listen, the safety here it says formaldehyde is dangerous to human health. The danger of formaldehyde is a major reason for the development of formaldehyde releasers, which release formaldehyde slowly at lower levels. So they used to just put the formaldehyde in the products, but because formaldehyde is dangerous, they decided to switch to the formaldehyde releasers, which release a small amount of it so that you're not getting a lot of formaldehyde. And before I talk about the amount of formaldehyde that's in products and kind of some more information about why the amount is important, I do want to note here that formaldehyde releasers can cause allergic reactions. Allergic reactions don't necessarily mean that something is dangerous for everybody, but it does mean that if you have a reaction to something, please discontinue the use, like, right away. I am allergic to a couple of things that if I see it on the ingredients list, I'm like, uh-uh, you're not coming home with me. You are not getting on my skin. You're not getting on my scalp, because I know that I'm going to be itching and burning and may have a little bit of a rash, okay? So it doesn't mean that those things are dangerous for other people. It's just that I personally have a couple of allergic reactions to some things. And then also they say cancer. And in order to get cancer from this ingredient, it needs to be in a very high dosage. You need to be getting exposed to a lot of it to cause cancer. And that's the kind of point that I want to get on here. So formaldehyde is in our food. Formaldehyde is in our food, but this is how this is tied to the dose, though. The amount of it that is in our food is so small that it's typically broken down. Our body naturally metabolizes it before it can come to our bloodstream and that kind of stuff. So it sounds scary, but I did want to talk about the small amount of it because it's going to help me further talk about the amount that's in our products. So this is super cool, y'all. Some of y'all are like, no, Kayla, this is not cool right now. We are upset with you because you just told us formaldehyde is in our food. So it's in a lot of fruits and vegetables. The list here, apples, bananas, grapes, plums, onions, carrots, and spinach on the vegetables. It can even be in some meats. And some animals, when they die, they begin to accumulate formaldehyde in their bodies. And people, of course, eat them as well. So while exposure to high levels of formaldehyde is dangerous, concern is mostly at the occupational level, where the EPA has set strict standards on how much workers can be exposed to in a given day. But for most people, it shouldn't even be a cause for concern. And you definitely shouldn't stop consuming fruits and vegetables. Even in cosmetics, the amount of formaldehyde present is equivalent to the amount of found in a pear or an apple. And its use is to prevent potentially dangerous bacteria, fungi, and yeast from forming, which they can make you more sick than the small amounts of formaldehyde, for sure. So yeah, so what you're getting in your bottle of OGX is equivalent to the formaldehyde that's in a pear or apple. And you know that you down that pear or that apple and you ain't worried about it, sis. So my last little thing here that I'm going to click on is about the dose. So there is this blog called The Beauty Brains. Well, it was a podcast, The Beauty Brains podcast, and they had a blog and all this stuff together. And it was two chemist guys, and they would make posts and podcasts about beauty topics, like, you know, formulation topics. I think one of them does work to formulate products. And they stopped the podcast, I think, unless they revived it. I remember last time I listened to it, I was a little irritated because they had a guest on there and she made a comment about Fenty and Rihanna, and I did not like that. I was like, wow, how uneducated are you? Just because you don't know about something and you clearly show that you don't know about it. But anyway, that's a side topic, y'all. She played it. I'm not even a Rihanna fan like that, for real, for real. But anyway, so this is a post they have about preservatives, and they are listing a bunch of them. So ones that come under fire. So we have here parabens, they have phenol derivatives, quats, alcohol, I can't pronounce this one, isothiazolones, organic acids, and others. And then of course they have here the formaldehyde donors. And this is what they say about the formaldehyde donors. Formaldehyde derivatives are the next most common preservative. These compounds interfere with membrane proteins, which kill microbes. Yay! They are effective against bacteria, fungi, and mold. Bad press and real safety concerns have led cosmetic chemists to stop using formaldehyde. Instead, ingredients that dissociate into formaldehyde when put into a water solution are used. These are compounds like DMDM Hydantoin, imidazolidinylurea, and glutaraldehyde. Yeah, glutaraldehyde. They are most commonly used in surfactant systems. Now they talk about each individual one, and then they say why the preservatives are vilified. They say more than any other ingredient, preservatives are most often called out as the worst ingredient you can use in a formula. Even people who know nothing about chemistry have likely heard about the evil parabens and formaldehyde. I know I have. You know, you guys have seen the bottles that are like paraben free. That is like on a long list of a lot of products, as they telling you there are no parabens up in here, sis, because they, you know, people are afraid of them. Preservatives are designed to kill cells. That's why they are effective. Unfortunately, that's also why they are potentially hazardous. They don't easily discriminate between good human cells and bad microbial cells. But ultimately, the risk from using preservatives is significantly lower than that of using unpreserved cosmetics. There are safe levels of toxic chemicals. All chemicals can be deadly if you're exposed to a high enough level. How many people die from water exposure, like drowning? Yes, water is a chemical, but some of y'all ain't ready for that discussion. Remember, it's the dose that matters. So they are putting such a small amount in the products that it really is not a concern of most people. However, if you do have an allergic reaction, you probably gonna have an allergic reaction anyway, regardless of the dose. So you probably need to discontinue use. Now, here's what I think is gonna happen. I think that OGX, in order to stay on shelves and to regain trust of the customer, is probably gonna just switch to another preservative that folks ain't heard of. That's what they're gonna do, because whenever the parabens were getting vilified, they switched over to using the formaldehyde releasers. And now the formaldehyde releasers are coming under fire. They're just gonna switch to some other preservative that folks haven't heard of. And they're just gonna keep doing it to stay on the shelves. And honestly, it's going to start a trend of catering to public concern. And I think other brands and other products will start to now use formaldehyde-free preservative methods. And so now, right under the list of paraben-free, it's going to be formaldehyde donor-free. That's what's going to happen, so that people can continue to feel safe about the cosmetics that they are using, despite knowing that the dose of formaldehyde that is coming out of the formaldehyde releasers is very, very low, comparable to that of some fruits and vegetables that are probably sitting on the counter in your house or sitting in the refrigerator in your house right now. If you are really, really into ingredients, check out my similar video on my detangling talk about the Diva Curl re-release and their reformulation of their ingredients. And I'm going to link another one of my ingredient heavy videos. Oh, let's do the one where it talks about different ingredients found in gels and the hold. Let's do that one. It's an older video, but it's a good one. Subscribe. I post videos every week, and I will talk to you in the next one.